The economic convulsions that racked Western societies between the two world wars were seen at the time by most Marxists as being the breakdown of the capitalist system which Marxist theory had always predicted. However, whereas according to the theory this was supposed to lead to communism, in not one single such Western society did communist regimes emerge. What did emerge in several of them was fascism. Some Marxists were disillusioned by this, to the point of abandoning Marxism. Others refused to question Marxist theory, regardless of what actually happened. But there were many in between, people who remained or wanted to remain Marxists, but who felt that Marxism would have to be seriously re-examined if it was to continue to remain credible. One such group of people came together in Frankfurt in the late 1920s and have come to be known since as the Frankfurt School. Actually, they didn't stay in Frankfurt long, but the name has stuck. They left Germany in the early 1930s, in the period just before and after the Nazis came to power, and by the mid-30s, the key figures had all settled in the United States. These, to mention three, were Adorno, a man who seemed equally at home in philosophy, sociology, and music, Horkheimer, a philosopher come sociologist, less brilliant than Adorno, but perhaps more solid, and the one who has turned out in the end to be the most famous and influential of them all, the political theorist Herbert Marcuse. Their influence grew slowly, but grew nevertheless over a long period and reached a spectacular peak in the 1960s. Many things contributed to this. One was the powerful revisionist movement among Marxist and communist countries throughout Eastern Europe, culminating in the Prague Spring of 1968. This put the Frankfurt School in line for the first time with real-life developments inside the communist world. Another, obviously related, was the tremendous revival of interest in Marxism among people in the West, especially educated young people. This also culminated in 1968, the year which saw the high point of student violence all over Europe and the United States, and looked for a moment in Paris as if it might even come close to genuine revolution. The would-be revolutionaries of that day proclaimed one man more than others as their political mentor, and that was Marcuse. They painted the walls with phrases from his books in order to make it known to the world that they were going to turn his ideas into reality. And although the revolution didn't materialize, during the decades since then, the ideas of Marcuse and the Frankfurt School have come to dominate some of the social science departments in various countries in Europe, and through them to have a continued and very important influence on the young. Professor Marcuse, why should it have been to your writings that the revolutionary student movements of the 1960s and early 70s turned?
Well, I was not the mentor of the student activists of the 60s and early 70s. What I did is formulate and articulate some ideas and some goals that were in the air at that time. That is about it. The student generation that became active in these years did not need a father figure or a grandfather figure in order to lead them to protest against a society which revealed daily its inequality, injustice, cruelty, and its general destructiveness. They could experience that. They saw it before their own eyes. As features of the society, I only mention the heritage of fascism. Fascism was militarily defeated. The potential for a repetition was still there. I would like to mention racism, sexism, the general insecurity, the pollution of the environment, the degradation of education, the degradation of work, and so on and so on. In other words, what exploded in the 60s and early 70s was a blatant contrast between the tremendous available social wealth and its miserable, destructive, and wasteful use.
And I think one might add, I mean, whether one agrees with your view on any or all of these matters or not, that the prevailing orthodoxies in philosophy in the colleges and universities throughout the West at this time simply didn't deal with these questions at all, did they? Certainly analytic philosophy didn't, positivism didn't, and so
on. They did not. And we in Frankfurt and later in the United States could not conceive of any authentic philosophy which did not in one way or the other reflect the human condition in its concrete situation, the social and political situation, and so on and so on. For us, philosophy has always been, to a great extent, social and political philosophy ever since Plato. Yes.
Of course, philosophy has been of enormous importance to you throughout your life. In fact, you've spent your life as a university teacher, lecturer, academic, writer of books, and so on. Mm-hmm. But one of the conspicuous features of the New Left movement that you have helped to father is its anti-intellectualism. Now, from the way you've lived your life, one wouldn't expect you actually to approve of that.
On the contrary, I combated this anti-intellectualism from the beginning. The reason for this anti-intellectualism are, in my view, the isolation of the student movement from the working class and the apparent impossibility of any spectacular political action. This led gradually to some kind of, let me say, inferiority complex. Some kind of self-inflicted masochism, which found expression, among other things, in this contempt for intellectuals because they are only intellectuals and don't achieve anything in reality.
I must say it's of unique interest to hear criticisms of the New Left from you, of all people. While we're on this subject, what other important defects do you think that the New Left movement has developed as it has gone along?
Well, I would mention perhaps as a main defect the unrealistic language and in many cases the totally unrealistic strategy among the New Left, by no means general, but very definitely among the New Left. The refusal to recognize that we are not in a revolutionary situation in the advanced industrial countries, that we are not even in a pre-revolutionary situation, and that the strategy has to be adapted to this situation. Secondly, among the New Left, again, that does by no means refer to all of the groups, among the New Left, the refusal to re-examine and to develop Marxian categories, to make a fetish out of Marxist theory, to treat the Marxian concepts as reified, objectified categories instead of becoming conscious finally of the fact that these are historical and dialectical concepts which cannot simply be transmitted, which have to be re-examined in accordance with the changes in the society itself.
I must say it's enormously refreshing to hear these words from your lips. I mean, it shows that you are still thinking afresh when people who regard themselves as followers of yours and are young enough to be your grandchildren have stopped thinking in some cases. But now you've brought us to what was really the guts of the Frankfurt School itself as it started, when you started talking about the re-examination of Marxist concepts. As I said in my introduction to this program, it was the feeling that Marxism had to be re-examined and reconstructed that gave rise to your movement, particularly as a result of fascism. But fascism wasn't the only thing that precipitated it, was it? I mean, there were other political factors too. Can you comment on what some of them were?
You mean some of the factors which demanded a revaluation of Marxian categories?
Yes.
To me, one of the most important ones concerns the concept of socialism itself. In the development of Marxian theory, not in Marx himself, but in the development of his theory, socialism has become, the concept has almost entirely been focused on a more rational, larger development of the productive forces. on an ever higher productivity of labor, on a more rational distribution of the project, instead of stressing that a socialist society, as Marx envisaged it, at least the younger Marx envisaged this, was a society qualitatively different from all preceding societies. Now, in what way qualitatively different? The main point, I would say, is for Marx, a genuine socialist society was a society in which the quality of life was decidedly different from the existing societies. Meaning, in a genuine socialist society, labor, full-time alienated labor, would no longer be the measure of wealth and value. In an authentic socialist society, men and women could live their life without fear, without being compelled to spend their entirely adult existence in alienated performances. This image has been obscured, and the result was some kind of frightening continuity between the developed and advanced capitalist societies and the image of a socialist society.
Yes, socialism began to become like its enemy, so to speak.
Exactly.
I know from your writings that you had other very central criticisms of Marxist theory. Two that I would like to mention, partly because they're probably connected in your mind, is that you regarded Marxism as anti-libertarian, or at least insufficiently libertarian, as the Marxist tradition developed, and you also thought that it didn't take sufficient account of the individual. Now, it would be very interesting to hear you comment on those two points.
Marx did not concern himself very much with the individual, and he didn't have to, because at his time, the very existence of the proletariat made this class a potentially revolutionary class. Now, things have changed considerably since. You know, the question is, to what extent can the present working class in the advanced industrial countries still be called a proletariat? The Western European countries have abandoned this concept altogether. Now, what has taken place is a large-scale integration of perhaps the majority of the population into the existing capitalist system. The organized working class, at least, no longer has nothing to lose but its chains, but a lot more. And this, in turn, took place not only on a material but also on a psychological basis. The consciousness of the dependent population changed. It was one of the most striking phenomena to see to what extent the ruling power structure could manipulate, manage, and control not only the consciousness, but also the subconscious and unconscious of the individuals. Therefore, my friends at the Frankfurt School considered psychology one of the main branches of knowledge that had to be integrated with Marxian theory. By no means replacing Marxian theory, but taking it into Marxian theory.
You yourself have done a lot in your writings to try to marry Freudianism and Marxism. And I think that some people would say that this simply can't be done. Because the two patterns of explanation are incompatible with each other. I mean, to put it extremely briefly, Marxist theory locates the ultimate level of explanation of human affairs in technique. The theory, put very simply, is that the level of development of the means of production in a society at any given time determine the formation of classes in that society, and that in turn determines the relationships of individuals to each other, and on that basis grow up what Marxists call the superstructure of ideologies, religions, philosophy, mm-hmm. art, and so on. Now, according to Freud, something entirely different is the ultimate explanation of human behavior. The ultimate explanation, according to him, lies in the repressed contents of the unconscious, our unconscious wishes, fantasies, fears, feelings, and so on, which are repressed as a result of distortions in our earliest relationships, above all with our parents. And he explains not only social behavior, but also ideologies, art, religion, and so on, in terms of the externalization of the repressed contents of the psyche. Now, these are two entirely different kinds of explanation of the same set of phenomena. How can you possibly marry the two into a single theory?
I think they can easily be married, and it may well be a very happy marriage. I think they are two extremely different interpretations of two different levels of the same whole, the same totality. The primary drives, the unconscious primary drives, which Freud stipulated, namely erotic energy and destructive energy, Eros and Thanatos, develop within a specific given social framework, which in one way or the other regulates the manifestation of these primary drives. Now, the social impact goes even further than that. According to Freud, the more intense the repression in a society, the more what happened is a mobilization of surplus aggressiveness against this repression. Now, since, again according to Freud, repression is bound to increase with the progress of civilization, at the same time and parallel to it, aggressive energy, surplus aggressiveness, is going to be mobilized and is going to be released. In other words, with the progress of civilization, we will have a progress in destructiveness. And it seems to me no hypothesis can better explain what happens today than that one.
I think the following thought will occur to some people listening to our discussion up to this point. You have catalogued a very formidable list of defects in Marxist theory and prediction. The failure to predict the future success of capitalism, the anti-libertarian element in Marxism, the absence of any theory or attitude to the individual. You've also talked about other entirely new theories like Freudianism, which came on the scene after Marx and therefore couldn't have been accommodated by Marx in his outlook. A lot of people will say, well, since you were so conscious of this enormous range of defects in Marxism, why did you want to remain Marxists? I mean, why try to hang on to a discredited or falsified theory? Why not try to liberate your thought categories from that altogether and actually look at reality afresh?
Easy answer, because I do not believe that the theory as such has been falsified. What has happened is that some of the concepts of Marxian theory, as I said before, will have to be re-examined, but this is not something from outside brought into Marxist theory, that is something Marxist theory itself as a historical theory demands. Now, it is relatively easy for me to enumerate, to give you a catalog of the decisive concepts of Marx which have been corroborated in the development of capitalism. The concentration of economic power, the fusion of economic and political power, the increasing intervention of the state into the economy, the increasing difficulties in stemming the tendential, the decline in the rate of profit, the need for engaging in a neo-imperialism in order to create markets and possibilities of enlarged accumulation of capital, and so on. I think this is a formidable catalogue, and it speaks a lot for Marxian theory.
Well, I don't want to get into a political argument. I'd love to do that, as a matter of fact. But, well, the purpose of this programme is to elicit your views on a further range of topics. But I can't let what you've said just pass like that. I mean, to take only the first two of your list, you said that there's been increasing concentration of economic power, but surely through the invention of the joint stock company, the ownership of capital has been more widely dispersed than ever before. You talk about the convergence of economic and political power. I would say yes, but what has happened in the West, at least, is that the decisive control over the economy has passed into the hands of elected politicians, who in the democracies are directly elected by the mass of the people, and they take the basic economic decisions in the society.
Well, you know that with your first statement about the joint stock companies, you express one of the main concepts of Marxist revisionism, introduced first by Engels himself. They considered the joint stock companies with a dispersed ownership already as preforms of a socialist society. Now, we know today that this is obviously wrong, and you will not maintain that, for example, in the great multinational corporations, the stockholders control the policy, national and global, of these corporations. It is not the ownership alone that matters, but the control of the productive forces, which is decisive. As far as the state is concerned and the role of the politicians, do you believe that the politicians make their decisions entirely by themselves as free individuals, or isn't there some kind of link between the policymakers and the great economic powers in the society?
Well, the politicians certainly aren't dominated by the great economic powers, but anyway, I think I will have to let that pass reluctantly and get back to the Frankfurt School. We've talked in general terms and about the Frankfurt School. Mm-hmm. I mentioned two or three of the individuals in my opening remarks, but I think it would be especially interesting to hear just a word from you about who the main individuals were and what they were like, because after all, they were your close friends and associates.
Well, Horkheimer was the director of the Institute. He was not only a thoroughly trained and knowledgeable philosopher and sociologist, but also in a strange sense, a financial wizard who could take care very well of the material basis, as it were, of the Institute, not only in Germany, but also afterwards in the United States. A brilliant man, and nothing that was written in the periodical of the Institute and afterwards was written without previous discussion with him and with the other collaborators at the Institute. Adorno, a genius. I have to call him a genius, because I have never seen anyone who was, as you already mentioned, so equally well at home in philosophy, sociology, psychology, music, whatever it may be. It was absolutely amazing. When he talked, it could be printed without any change. It was perfectly ready for print. Then are those who are unjustly neglected or forgotten. Leo Lohnthal, the literary critic of the Institute. Franz Neumann, a brilliant legal philosopher. Otto Kirchheimer, equally familiar in legal philosophy, Frederick Pollock, and especially Hendrik Grossmann, the most orthodox of all Marxist economists I have ever met. He predicted the collapse of capitalism for a very specific year he gave. In the meantime, it turned out it wasn't quite correct.
Like the medieval churchman predicting the end of the
exactly,
world.
Exactly, yes. Exactly. And Pollock, who after all wrote, I think, the first article, in which he tried to argue that there are no compelling internal reasons why capitalism should collapse.
Now, one of the things that you all as a group pioneered in the perhaps late 20s, and certainly early 30s, was the shift of interest in Marx's studies back from the works of the mature Marx to the works of the earlier Marx, the things he wrote when he was more directly under the influence of Hegel. And one of the things, one of the many things, I think, that came out of that, which has been of continuing influence ever since, is the an interest in the notion of alienation. I think alienation in its modern sense was coined by Hegel, taken up and given a new significance by Marx, and then almost, you can say, fell out of Western thought for nearly 100 years. And you, plural, were instrumental in bringing it back, weren't you? It would be very interesting to hear your comments on the importance of this idea.
Well, that's a very complicated story. According to Marx, alienation was a socio-economic concept. And it meant, basically, this is a very brute and brutal abbreviation, that under capitalism, men and women could not, in their work, fulfill their own individual humane faculties and needs. That this was due to the capitalist mode of production itself, and could only be remedied by radically changing this mode of production. Now today, the concept of alienation has been expanded and extended to such an extent that this original content is almost entirely lost. An extension all too easy, which I consider not only premature, but also wrong, because, for example, not every kind of trouble or problem someone has with his girlfriend or a boyfriend is necessarily due to the capitalist mode of production.
In other words, you think that the idea has been trivialized.
Trivialized, and it very needs to be restored.
Yes, and that it's in its original significance, it is of fundamental importance.
Fundamental.
Yes, yes. We've talked up to this point in our discussion in rather negative terms. We've talked about what the Frankfurt School was against. We've talked about its critique of Marxism and, at least by implication, its critique of the capitalist system. What was its positive contribution?
Well, I would say, to start with the easiest one, its decisive positive contributions was a prediction of fascism long before it actually happened. Secondly, what Horkheimer himself considered as a distinguishing characteristic, the interdisciplinary approach to the great social and political problems of the time, cutting across the academic division of labor, applying sociology, psychology, philosophy, to the understanding and developing of the problems of the time. And in my view, the most interesting contribution, the attempt to answer the question, what actually has gone wrong in Western civilization, that at the very height of technical progress, we see at the same time the opposite as far as human progress is concerned. Dehumanization, brutalization, the torture again as normal means of interrogation, the wasteful development of nuclear energy, destructiveness everywhere and so on. How has this happened? And he, especially Horkheimer, but also the others, went back into not only a social but also intellectual history and tried to define the interplay between progressive and repressive categories throughout the intellectual history of the West, especially in the Enlightenment, for example, which is usually considered as one of the most progressive phases in history, and the Frankfurt School pointed out to what extent this apparently perfectly clear progressiveness, this liberating tendency, was at the same time tied up with regressive and repressive tendencies.
This picture that you paint of a group of Marxists almost obsessed with the question, what has gone wrong, suggests to me a politics of disillusionment. I mean, there seems to be an aura about it of disappointed hopes, disappointment with a Marxist theory, disappointment perhaps even with the working class itself for failing to be an effective instrument of revolution. Was there something disappointed or disillusioned or pessimistic at the center of your approach in those days?
Well, if a disappointment means, as you formulated, disappointment with the working class, I would decidedly reject it. None of us has a right to blame the working class for what it is doing or what it is not doing. So this kind of disappointment, certainly not. There was indeed another disappointment, and that seems to me a very objective attitude. I mentioned it before, namely that the incredible social wealth that had been assembled in Western civilization and mainly as the achievement of capitalism was increasingly used for destroying rather than constructing a more decent and humane society. If you call that disappointment, yes, but I think it's a very justified and objective disappointment.
And you saw your central task as being an investigation of the reasons as to why that was
exactly
so. How had it come about? So the essential enterprise of the Frankfurt School was a critical one.
Definitely.
Yes.
Therefore, the term critical theory today,
yes,
for the writings of the Frankfurt,
yes,
School.
One thing that the members of the Frankfurt School exhibited very considerable concern with from the beginning was aesthetics. And this, I think, differentiates it from most other philosophies, certainly from most other political philosophies. And you yourself have written a lot in recent years about aesthetic matters. Why did you and your colleagues always regard aesthetics as so important?
Well, I believe, and it was Adorno who is to whom I'm closest in this respect, I believe that in art, literature, and music, insights and truth are expressed which cannot be communicated in ordinary language, let's say in prose for brevity's sake, and that with these truths, images, the image of an entirely new dimension is opened, which is either repressed or tabooed in reality. Namely, the image of a human existence and of nature no longer confined within the norms of a repressive reality principle, but really a striving for their fulfillment and gratification, even at the price of death and catastrophe. I tried to illustrate it by saying that let me use a terrible word, the message of art and literature is that actually the world should be experienced so as the lovers of all times experienced it, as King Lear experienced it, as Anthony and Cleopatra experienced it. In other words, a rupture with the established reality principle, at the same time the invocation of the images of liberation.
In other words, what you're saying now ties up with what you were saying very near the beginning of our discussion about your insistence that socialism should be concerned with a different quality of life,
exactly,
and not only with material,
exactly,
matters. And that means that you, at least, see literature as a repository of new values, and you don't just see it as a critique of existing society or a revolutionary instrument in the way that many Marxist critics, literary critics,
I would say it is all authentic literature is both. It is on the one hand accusation of the existing society, But on the other hand, and internally linked to it, always the images of liberation. I certainly do not believe that you can give any adequate explanation of a literary work simply in terms of the class struggle or whatever it may be.
Well, this is a field in which thinkers in the tradition of the Frankfurt School, like yourself, are now doing fresh and original work. What other areas do you think this school of philosophy, this tradition of philosophy, is going to have to concern itself with in the immediate future?
Well, I can in this respect only talk of myself. And I would say that far more attention should be paid to the women's liberation movement. I see in the women's liberation movement today a very strong radical potential. Now, I would have to give a lecture in order to explain why I do that. Unfortunately, I cannot. Let me at least try to say it in two sentences. All domination in recorded history up to today was patriarchal domination. So if we should indeed live to see not only a equality of the woman before the law or whatever it is, but the deployment of what is called the specific feminine quality throughout the society, for example, non-violence, receptivity, tenderness, this would indeed be, or perhaps could be, the beginning of a qualitatively different society, the very antithesis to male domination with its violent and brutal character. Now, I'm myself perfectly conscious of the fact that these so-called specific feminine qualities are socially conditioned.
I was going to say, there are people who would regard it as sexist to say that
all right.
They are
now,
specifically
they
feminine.
Are, I don't
qualities.
Care. They are socially yes. conditioned, but to a great extent they are available, they are there. So why not use them the way they are, regardless of the question as to their origin?
I'd like to end our discussion, Professor Marcuse, by putting to you one or two of the main criticisms that are commonly made of your work. I've really put the chief one to you already, and that was a long way back in the discussion when I said to you, given your awareness of so many things wrong with Marxism, why do you remain a Marxist? I won't put that to you again because you've already indicated what your reply
because
is.
Because I think it's correct.
Yes, but there are others too. For example, it's commonly said of the New Left movement that has developed to such a large degree out of your work, that it is elitist, that you have these little groups of, for the most part, middle class and some would say self-admiring intellectuals, divorced from the working class, as you yourself acknowledged earlier, regarding themselves as the instruments of revolution. And that the whole thing has become trendy, has become fashionable, and above all has become dissociated with the real working class that it was all supposed originally to be about.
Well, the term elitist I would reject entirely. I think it is another expression of the self-inflicted masochism among the New Left. It isn't an elitism. What we have are simply groups, which I would like to call catalyst groups, which, because of the privilege of their education and training, indeed develop intelligence, theory, as remote from the material process of production. That cannot be remedied by any dictum. This can be remedied only in the process of change itself. Now, I have never maintained that these catalyst groups could ever replace the working class as subjects and agents of the revolution. They are educational groups, mainly political, but not only political education. Their main task is the development of consciousness, trying to counteract the management and control of consciousness by the established power structure, and so on. But they are certainly not a substitute for the working class itself. Now, the second point you brought up, the language. To a great extent,
now,
I
this
agree.
Was, if I may stop you here, Professor Marcuse, this was something I said to you before we went on the air to tape this program. So let me say it again so that the viewers will know. This was something that I was saying in criticism of you when we were talking earlier. What I said then, and I'll repeat it now, is that I think something that may sound like a trivial criticism, but is not trivial, is that so many of the writings of the Frankfurt School are in fact very, very difficult to read. Worse than that, they're turgid, sometimes unintelligible. I exempt, and I do it sincerely, yours from this. Your writings
are... They're bad enough.
Your writings... Adorno, for example. Earlier in this discussion, you described Adorno as a genius. Now, I find some Adorno literally unreadable. Now, that seems to me to constitute an enormous barrier between the ideas you were trying to disseminate and the public you were trying to disseminate them to. And this is a serious criticism. And if anything, it's made greater by the fact that other alternative philosophies are often expounded by writers who are very good writers. For example, in the analytic tradition, there is almost a tradition of wit and verve. I mean, Bertrand Russell won the Nobel Prize for Literature. So, incidentally, did Jean-Paul Sartre, probably the leading exponent of existentialism. So when one reads existentialism or analytic philosophy...
You concealed Heidegger.
I deliberately didn't mention Heidegger because he doesn't fit my thesis.
Exactly.
But nevertheless, I think it is fair to say that the writings of the Frankfurt School as a whole are extraordinarily turgid. Now, why was that? Why is it?
Well, to some extent, I agree with you. And I confess that there are many things in Adorno I don't understand. I want at least to say one word about his justification. It was that ordinary language, ordinary prose, even a little sophisticated one, has been so much permeated by the establishment, by the express so much the controls and the manipulation of the individual by the power structure, that already in the language you use, you have to indicate the rupture with conformity. Therefore, the attempt to convey this rupture already in the syntax, in the grammar, in the vocabulary, whatever it may be. Now, whether or not that is acceptable, I don't know. The only thing I would say, there is an equally great danger in a premature popularization of the terribly complex problems we face today.
We've reached the end of our discussion now, Professor Marcuse, but to close, I would like to put a personal question to you, and I do it because you've had an experience in life which must have happened to remarkably few human beings in history. You've spent almost a whole lifetime as an academic known to a comparatively small circle, your pupils, the readership of the rather specialized readership of your books and articles. And then suddenly, when you were literally nearly 70, you became, almost overnight, one is tempted to say, a world figure. Now, this is an astonishing thing to happen to anyone. What was it like to have it happen to you?
Well, on the one hand, I enjoyed it tremendously. On the other hand, I found it somehow not deserved. And I may end, if this is the end, on a rather impertinent note. It isn't so impertinent. I always said, when I was asked, how is that possible? I said, I appear only as such a figure because the others are still more stupid than I am.
But no one could ever have expected it, and I suppose you never expected it, did you?
No, I certainly didn't.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Marcuse.